So we'll just say that you're all British. Because, like, you seem like a great group. I want to be able to take all of you over, so we'll just say you're all British. So my next question. How many of you are married?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? Oh, yeah. Okay, so, again, married men right now.
What?
They can bring, you know, their significant others with them. So I'm just going to need all of you to get married.
Okay.
I mean, do it really quick. If your significant other isn't super interested in coming to Canada, that's fine. Just marry someone else. It'll be great. So you're all married. You're all British. We're making some really good progress. I'm curious, what are your occupations? Got some, like, laborers, maybe teachers? Is that?
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Well, I have some great news for you. I have a copy of the Penny Immigrant's Guide to the United States and Canada, and in it, I can give you some direct quotes on the teaching opportunity. We'll be welcome in the Western states to board and lodging, which will be a help to them while looking for some more suitable situation. But they will receive very little pay. I believe the most suitable part for them is Western Canada, where very much attention is now being paid to education and where school salaries can be readily added to by means of private tuition in an evening. So you all will have plenty of opportunity being teachers in Western Canada. This is really looking up for you all. I don't think I've even introduced myself. What am I doing here? Hello, my name is Mary Cribb and I'm representing the Hudson's Bay Company on this fine morning. They are who I work for, and they run and operate most of the trading in the Oregon Territory. Now, what do you all know about the fine establishment that is the Hudson's Bay Company? Anything?
Birds.
Exactly. Our company began as a fur trading operation. Throughout most of the 1820s to 1830s, we were running almost all of the trading in the Pacific Northwest, and we have a really long history throughout Canada and the United States. Just recently, in 43, opened up Fort Victoria on Vancouver Island. We did this both to protect our own trading interests as well to kind of protect Britain's claim on the land. It was chosen by James Douglas because it's a protected harbor with fertile land, and it's a beautiful area of Vancouver Island. So that is where I want to take all of you. In fact, just this year, Vancouver Island became a colony. So, like, it's a pretty big deal. Not even the mainland is a colony yet. What would one day be BC? That's not even a colony. They just, like, skipped over. It's fantastic. Go back to my Penny Immigrant's Guide. They note the fact that I would strongly recommend one intending to buy land to see it first and satisfy himself that it is good, as there is much trickery on this subject, especially in the part of land companies in England. And it is likely as not that land bought in England, as thought of very cheap, turns out to be sickly swamp or barren sand or a grand extent of rock or otherwise worthless. So, not only are you going to the incredibly fertile land of Victoria, but you're going to be able to see your own land and purchase it for yourself. You're going to be so independent, it's going to be an economically great opportunity. I highly recommend it. So, I think we're all ready to go. So we're going to go ahead and hop on the Norman Morrison, which is a ship owned by the Hudson's Bay Company, and it's actually pictured on all of your guides. So of course, we have to pack. What are some things that you all believe would be essentials when traveling to the New World?
Clothes?
Fantastic, yes. You're going to want to stay warm and have something to wear.
I want to bring my tea set.
Yeah, you're going to want something to drink.
A good pair of boots.
Absolutely, something to walk in and to work in so your feet stay warm.
My Sunday best.
Of course. After all, you're going to be bringing your religious beliefs and cultural beliefs with you. 3 quarts of water daily, as well as on a weekly basis, you'll get 2.5 pounds of bread or biscuit, 1 pound of wheaten flour, 5 pounds of oatmeal, 2 pounds of rice, 1.5 pounds of sugar, 2 ounces of tea or 4 ounces of cocoa or coffee, and 2 ounces of salt. Those will usually be prepared in a meal. You'll also, of course, want to bring along things like tools, household items, any essentials that you'll need when setting up your new home and your new life. So, we are now on the ship. What are some things that might be a problem when traveling on a ship?
Rats.
Rats could be a problem. I think we have a great example up front here. Seasickness can be a huge issue. What? Well, it can depend on the ship you're taking. The trip across the Atlantic Ocean alone can take 6 to 9 weeks. But then we have to go south all the way around Cape Hope in South America. And that journey just around Cape Hope can take up to 2 months because the weather is so rough and the winds are going in the opposite direction as we are. And then we'll head right back up to Vancouver Island. The journey in total will take around 5 months. If we leave today, we'll be arriving in March of 1850. So, going along with the topic of illness, actually now that we're all on our ship together, we have one issue. We had a smallpox breakout, but thankfully we had a doctor on board, Dr. Helmiken, who was able to handle the situation super well, and only one person died. So one of you is dead. Apologies, you didn't make it to the New World. Dr. Helmiken would actually go on to be the founding president of the British Columbia Medical Association, as well as play a really important role in the Federation of the Colony of British Columbia with the rest of Canada. So, and he was on your ship. Like, that's a pretty big deal. So now we have arrived at the fort. So many of you will spend years working here. We're part of the only non-Aboriginal people in the area. The fort never exceeded a population of around 150 people, and most of them were part of the Hudson's Bay Company as well. We ended up opening a bar near the naval base on the island, and then later a farm, and his 3 surviving daughters then moved into mainland BC and lived there. So. It's a bit of my own family history thrown in there as well. So of course, that's just the Canadian side of things. There's also the American side of things. Kind of developed in this area from west to east. They really populated Vancouver Island and then kind of moved into BC, whereas in the United States, it was more east to west. The Northwest Company, which was the major competition with the Hudson's Bay Company, established the Spokane House in 1810. Spain ceded its original Pacific Northwest claims to the United States in the Transcontinental Treaty of 1819. And then the Hudson's Bay Company established Fort Nisqually, the first non-Indian settlement in the Puget Sound, in April of 1833. Then, in June of 1846, Britain cedes its claims to the Pacific Northwest through the Treaty of Oregon, which is what established that under the 49th parallel is the United States, and above it is Canada. Many settlers in this region would have been English, Irish, and Scottish. So, one of the people that traveled across the Oregon Trail from the east to the west is Nicholas B. Schaefer, and I have some of his notes on the journey. I'm going to read to you. It was in the spring of 1850 that I started for Oregon, with 2 yoke of oxen and 1 yoke of cows. The company which I started was overloaded and made slow progress. A number of the party died from cholera, which broke out on our train. It was getting late in the season when we reached the summit of the Rocky Mountains at South Pass. The train was demoralized, and I was afraid it would never get through. Myself and the owner of 3 other wagons concluded to cut loose and make for Salt Lake, which we did. The main train taking the right and we to the left. I have never heard anything of those who stuck on the main trail from that time on. We made very good time after leaving and reached Salt Lake safely. It was our intention to go on to California over the Sierra Nevada mountains, crossing near Humboldt Lake, but we were informed in Salt Lake that it was too late in the season. They said we might get over the mountains on snowshoes, but that couldn't take the stock room. I had started for Oregon, all this country was Oregon then, and my compass pointed me this way. Me and the party stuck up along the coast. We found some good traveling and some very bad, almost impassable. One place in particular in a canyon We were 3 days making 8 miles. Some places we had to take our wagons apart and carry them part by part for some distance. But our men as well as our women were of good mettle, and we made it because we had to. So settlers on both sides of the border would rely on trading, logging, and coal to be the beginnings of the economies in those areas. Much longer before then, were the First Nations and Indigenous peoples of the regions. The Coast Salish are a very big, loose grouping of the many tribes with numerous distinct cultures and languages. Territory claimed by the Coast Salish people span from the northern limit of the Gulf of Georgia and the inside of Vancouver Island and covers most of southern Vancouver Island and all the lower mainland and most of the Puget Sound. They evolved complex cultural, social, and economic structures, which the invasion of Euro-American settlers in the mid-1800s almost erased. But continue today as the tribes struggle for their survival, respect, and renewal. First Nations as tribes played very important roles in the development of both nations through trade as well as guides for travel and farming in the region. They were often also viewed as a threat to settlers. I actually have a newspaper clipping from my Great Times 4 grandmother describing her father's experience. Which also highlights the fact that they were angry that they were claiming their land, and it's like, well, yeah, of course they were. A huge role. It would bring a ton of immigrants into California and then up through Washington and D.C. as well. British Columbia actually experienced two gold rushes. The first took place in 1858 after gold was discovered on the Fraser River. Victoria, until then a sleepy English village of a few hundred people, was transformed into a tent city of some 30,000 within weeks of the spring of 1858, and among 4,000 of them were Chinese. The second one, which occurred in Corobu, took place in 1862, and due to the influx of people in the area from as far as Germany and China, all of whom had come to chase after gold fortune, famous towns such as Bakerville, Richfield, and Kenneth Creek sprung up, and there was an increased development in the mainland. This opened up British Columbia to settlement by people of non-Aboriginal descent. So, that was a lot, and we were on this beautiful place called Tsusha, which is kind of in the middle. It's technically not Canada, but it also kind of feels like it's technically not the United States. It's such an in-between. Salish tribes, for more than 2,500 years, or since time immemorial, for summer hunting and foraging. Specifically, this area was used because it was a resource for fresh water. And in this area, in particular, this actually used to be an estuary, and it had been used for things like clam and oyster and different shellfish hunting and resource gathering. In terms of the history of the settlements on this island, the Wiggins family, so they were the first known Euro-American settlement. Settler being Charles Henry Wiggins, who moved to the island in the late 1880s. The thing was, at this time, settlement on the island was technically illegal, and it had been illegal since 1800. He moved here with his wife, Mary Lutzer, which was a member of one of the local tribes. They had previously lived on Warden Island, but they left for Tsusha after government agents seized 8 of their children and took them to an Indian school in Salem, Oregon. The couple had 5 more children on Tsusha and established a farm with fruit trees, cows, and sheep. They actually drained out the estuary here and were using it to raise grass so they could feed their cows and sheep. The family feared raiding parties who were coming here for things like the fresh water and the resources, and would even use things like bells to alert their children when the parties were coming or when they saw them so their kids could climb up trees or hide in the forest and stay safe. Which would come in the 1920s would be the Horton family. They made their income from boating. They delivered meals and supplies to the different islands in the area and also provided excursions for tourists. Now, this was also Prohibition at this period of time, and they had a pretty cordial relationship with the smugglers in the area, with one of their daughters even marrying a rum runner later in her life. And Mrs. Horton once went to visit her sister, who had running water in her house, and was so impressed by it that when she came back to the island, she insisted that they needed running water too. So they actually installed a well and a pump that delivered water to the valley for them. So quarrying, like we mentioned earlier. Where we're camping now is where a majority of the sandstone quarry took place, but I think we can maybe see it from here. We might need to move. Yeah, how about let's all move? I think now's a grand time. So let's go ahead and get up and get moving.